My name is Stefan. I'm one of the people that created Flink, now working at a company that used to be called Data Artisans, has been acquired recently, and for legal reasons now called differently. I would like to talk to you a little bit about what the Flink community is currently working on. There has been all this idea of batch and streaming and trying to get them both together and what nice things you can do if you actually manage to do that. That has been around for a while, but it's not yet fully happened. So I'd like to give you an update where we are, why this is actually a hard thing, and what our current approach to this is. And yeah, I think this is something that, you know, while I'm talking about it in the context of Apache Flink, I think this is, there's a lot of stuff in there that translates also to more general how to think about batch and streaming. And I had a few alternative talk titles also that I was thinking about, but that I didn't use in the end. But yeah, the best one's probably the last one, because that's a not very uncommon question that we get. For 4 years or so, there's now these two different APIs where the data stream API can somehow do batch and streaming. Somehow the dataset API can only do batch, and there's been talked about unifying them both forever. And what's actually the challenge behind that, and what is the plan to do this now? All right, so this is work that is done by a lot of people in the Apache Flink community. It's a pretty big effort. There's probably at least 20 people in the broader context of the Flink community working on this. I have some names here. I probably forgot half of them. So, and also bear in mind, this is an open source project. This talk is capturing what the current state of all these discussions are, what the current status of all these discussions and the current ideas. If somebody comes up with a brilliant idea tomorrow, we may flip it around. Probably not, but you know, this is not a definitive agenda. It's like the Apache disclaimer. Okay, so yeah, this is basically just a summary of current ideas. All right, just to set the context a little bit, right? The idea of Apache Flink is stateful computation over data streams. That does sound a lot like stream processing. But we're explicitly not saying stream processing anymore in the last 1 or 2 years even, because the idea of what you can do with this paradigm is actually quite a lot more than what is often understood as stream processing. So basically everything that can come in the form of a sequence of events into the system and produces some form of output, be that calls into applications, be that other streams, be that modifications to databases and so on, can be somehow represented as a program that computes over data streams. And maybe this makes it a little more, you know, a little more graspable. The idea is really it's a much broader spectrum than just let's say stream processing is what I think classical stream processing captures. Classical stream processing probably started out in these use cases. This is also where Flink started out, but in the last years, the system has exceedingly more developed towards adding more and more to do competitive batch processing and going also more to the real-time application side, doing really becoming more as a framework that's starting to be interesting to actually build online applications on. So today the talk is really more about this side here of the efforts. What do you do to really capture the essence of batch processing properly in a framework that's inherently based on streaming principles? Let's put it like that. And while a lot of this is work in progress, there's actually, I just want to highlight this, also quite a bit that Flink can already do these days around the area of, yeah, currently more stream processing. Parts of these use cases start to go into batch processing areas. So this is just an example of the use of Apache Flink inside Alibaba on Singles Day, which is the Chinese equivalent of Black Friday or Cyber Monday, like a big shopping holiday. The Flink clusters are really processing an aggregate of 1.7 billion events per second already, with hundreds of terabytes of in-flight state, not data that goes into the system, but contextual state in aggregation functions, in in updated machine learning models and so on, while maintaining sub-second end-to-end latency. So this is it's quite something. And yeah, Alibaba is not the only user of Flink by far these days. Those are just a bunch of logos we collected on the with the Flink community on the website, use cases that have either spoken at Flink Forward or appeared on the Flink blog sharing what they're doing with the system. All right, so in order to explain a bit better what it means to unify batch and streaming in a data processing system like Flink, I'd like to do a quick recap on what is the relationship between batch and streaming. And I think there has been quite a bit of content on that before, also in this conference here with the talks from, for example, from the Apache Beam project, which has a very similar thinking about this. So let me go through this quickly and then maybe dive into a few aspects that I think are quite maybe a bit more Flink specific or a bit more intricate for what we're talking about here today. So the very basic premise of all this work is, everything has to kind of follow a common representation. You can only unify batch and streaming in some sense if there's a common way to look at both of these things. And this common way is a stream, right? So we're really thinking everything is a stream. That is kind of the starting philosophy of projects like Apache Flink and Apache Beam. So a stream can be a sequence of records in a message queue or log like Apache Kafka or Amazon Kinesis. It can be a sequence of requests and to a service with the corresponding responses. You might have seen this in the context of when somebody talks about event sourcing architectures. But it can also be just a sequence of other data points in files that appear periodically, right? So this is as much a stream as this is a stream. It's just that this stream is maybe a bit more coarse-grained organized. It might, data might appear with higher latency and so on. And you've probably also heard, if you attended some of the Beam talks before or the Flink talks in previous conferences, that looking at a stream, thinking of a stream as generally an unbounded thing, you can look at a batch as just a subsection of that stream. So a batch is really a bounded substream in some sense. So a bounded substream is not necessarily always a chunk of a stream that is complete. A bounded substream might also start somewhere in the past and have a well-defined ending point in the future. It might be something that's completely in the past, right? If I'm training a machine learning model over some data from Q1 this year, and this is a bounded stream that is completely in the past. Conversely, an unbounded stream might just be an application that I'm starting now, and it's reacting to the events coming from now on into the future. Or it's something that I start at the beginning of when I started collecting my streaming records. So I'm basically crunching through the past, and at some point I'm reaching the present, and I'm continuing from there. So this is probably why this notion of batch is just a bounded stream, and with that, batch processing is just a special case of stream processing. This idea has been floating around for a while. And that is that's a very good start, but I think that's about 60% of the truth. The remainder, there's something else, and I think that there's something else you'd probably intuitively think when you say, okay, so why do streaming APIs and batch APIs really make still slightly different offer slightly different constructs? Why has nobody really done any batch processing with Storm or so ever? So there must be something else, right? Batches cannot just be bounded streams. And I think, this yellow thing here is not from us. This means clean the filter. I think that comes from the projector. So just imagine this is not on the slides. Okay, I think the remaining 40% are somehow implicitly captured in that image. And that's, again, an image I borrowed from Apache Beam. It's the event time low watermark. Just to quickly give context, for those of you who have not followed Beam and Flink all that closely, the event time low watermark, or just the watermark, is kind of a construct that came out of the data flow model that is a way of modeling progress in streams. So as event comes and data becomes more complete, as of a certain point in time, you advance this notion of completeness. This is the event time low watermark. And then it has become, I think, a very, very prominent concept in all stream processors, but it's actually somehow never in a batch processor, right? At least, I don't know, if you think about batch processing with Hadoop or Spark or, you know, just your SQL queries, there's not a watermark in there. So there's a little more to the difference between batch and streaming than a batch just being a bounded stream. I think one way to look at this is the following. Whenever you're dealing with continuous streaming or systems that build for continuous streaming, they usually have something in there to deal with the idea that data is inherently incomplete. So as data arrives as a stream in real time, it might always be that something else that is relevant to you will arrive in the next millisecond or 10 milliseconds in the future or 10 seconds in the future. You can never be quite sure that you've seen everything you want to have seen to make this decision, right? On the other hand, you cannot just wait forever to make a decision because you usually have latency SLAs, right? So some answer has to be produced. If you're not doing this within a certain amount of time, it's probably useless, right? I mean, if a credit card transaction is fraudulent, you probably want to know this within the first 50 milliseconds so you can still block the transaction. So you don't want to learn about this 5 seconds later when the payment has been authorized. And between completeness and latency, there's a trade-off, right? You can always wait just a little longer and see the more complete picture, or you output your result a little earlier and meet a more aggressive SLA. And I think this is something that this watermark encapsulates, right? And this is something that in batch, you're not worrying about at all. So in batch processing, you're just assuming, okay, input to the batch, to my model training, to my SQL query or so is this snapshot of data, and that's it. I'm not thinking that something might come in addition and then I'll try to update the query later. This is not classical batch processing. So you're basically just, you don't have this idea of any low latency SLAs or trading off completeness and latency. And that actually results in quite different ways for systems to operate, right? And again, I think intuitively a lot of you will probably have seen this. So let's look at how actually applications go through data in real-time stream processing. Let's just assume this is maybe something like Kafka, Pulse, or Kinesis or so, right? So think of these as events that span a certain time spectrum or shards or, you know, something showing up, and you know, as new data shows up, the system receives it and it advances the watermark as far, let's say, within this stream or within this partition as it can, and gradually goes through it. You know, let's just speed this up, and processes it, you know, as new data arrives. Now, let's look at just processing this exact stream not as a potentially unbounded real-time stream, but as a stream that's already there. You know, we have everything still in Kafka, we rewind our offsets by a few days, and we're reprocessing it. And in some sense, we're still doing the exact same thing, maybe a little faster because you don't have to wait for the events to arrive, but they're already there in the queue. But we're still kind of processing them like that, right? Just a bit faster, but we're still processing them in order, kind of in the order in which they were received. On the other hand, if you look at what a typical batch processor does, let's just assume these would now be segments that have been offloaded from Kafka to a file system and we would run a batch job over it. What would most likely happen is that we're not trying to read them in order or anything. We're just like, we're creating all the input splits or input partitions in Hadoop, Flink, Spark Speak or so, and then just read them in any order. And when they're all ingested at the very end of the batch program conceptually, we just say, yeah, okay, now time advances, now we're producing a result, right? So the whole idea of batch processing is just speed up the reads in a massively parallel fashion. Don't try to reproduce the ingestion order that we had in stream processing, right? And you can again kind of relate this actually to this idea of watermarks and latency completeness trade-off. So the stream processor just doing stream processing also when all the data is already there and working on a bounded stream is inherently still following this model, producing watermarks for completeness latency trade-off. Versus the batch processor just says, yes, I'm not trying to determine intermediate progress or so. I'm just like ingesting everything, doing my computation, and then dumping everything once I'm done. And because you want to generate watermarks, you do actually need to follow the same order of rereading the data as you originally had. Otherwise, there's no idea of generating incremental process. And this has actually another implication that often means that you're limited to the parallelism of the original ingestion, right? For example, if you're, let's say you're producing your data and four Kafka partitions are good for your data rate, right? And you have four partitions forever, you're also reading with four tasks or four threads in the future versus, you know, if you're just dumping this over the years into something like S3 and you've generated 10,000 objects, you can potentially read with 10,000 readers these objects and just go much faster through it. But again, this massively parallel out of order ingestion really is only applicable in cases where we're not trying to make incremental process a progress. So this whole idea of being optimized for incremental progress in stream processors versus not being optimized for incremental progress in batch processors is, I think, where the toughest challenge is to get both of them, getting both of them together in one system that's actually equally good at doing both things. Low latency results in stream processing and really high throughput results in batch processing. So that might be a very subtle characteristic, but has very big implications on system design. And this is why, if you look at how the systems are written, like how, for example, Spark is written versus Flink is written, right? Flink being stream processing first, batch on top, Spark being batch processing top, first streaming on top, is really very, very different. So if you want to actually build a system that can do both of these things well, what would be a way to do this? What would that mean both for system architecture and APIs? And I think on the API side has been quite a lot of work, both in Flink and Beam project. On this side, I think this is still a very interesting and challenging topic. I think this has actually not been solved before. I don't think there's a single system that really has a nice runtime that supports both stream and batch processing well. If you look at things like, for example, Cloud Dataflow, you have the same API, but it's completely different runtime systems that execute it if you have a batch job or if you have a streaming job. Even if you look at Flink's APIs today, the data set and the data stream API do something quite different underneath the hood. Let me actually dive a little bit in what Flink is trying to do to actually try to build the first stack that is really the same stack in batch and streaming. And one way we're starting with the notion of streaming as the more general approach. So we're starting with a program which is a streaming data flow. It goes through some component planner, optimizer, plan translator. And there's a set of continuous operators and streaming scheduler rules that are used to execute this. And these actually form still the core operators that cover all cases. Now, as we see, there's a few things that where I think we have contradicting requirements for certain, let's say, internal data structures, whether you want to optimize them for latency or for throughput, which is what we're trying to do is we're trying to think a little bit about it like a database optimizer. You do have kind of the same runtime, but you do have a few extra operators and scheduling strategies that you can activate if you figure out that, you know, this is actually a bounded set of data where you're not interested in making incremental progress. So in some sense, that sounds like, well, you guys are actually not trying to unify it after all. You're having two things or just making a choice. I hope it becomes clearer what the notion behind this is in the future. Even though following this idea of saying we do extend the pool of operators a little bit, if we're on the bounded case, we're trying to do this as little as possible. And still, the streaming operators will do a majority of the heavy lifting. And still, it has to be the same core network infrastructure, the same core operator and threading model and everything that has to support both of these approaches. So let's actually look at exactly those two parts here. What do you have to change in a system to allow actually running both continuous operators and bounded operators highly efficiently and schedule things efficiently for both batch and streaming? So it turns out on the scheduling and recovery side, Flink is almost actually good. So it's actually pretty much has a compatible approach with that forever. Let me quickly recap how this actually works internally in Flink. So programs are translated to a parallel streaming data flow. And what the system then internally does is it tries to identify so-called pipelined regions. Now, if you have a system that is incrementally processing and outputting data, that usually means that your entire job ends up as one pipelined region, right? Because as soon as an event goes in here, it might have to just flow through the whole stack immediately. Now, if you're working on bounded data or you're running an SQL query over a table that isn't changing, or we're just looking at a static snapshot, what the system actually does is it injects certain pipeline breakers. So that means these are points where the streams are not really forwarded in a streaming fashion, but this is a point where the stream is first fully collected and materialized, and then it is sent out to the next consumer. And this actually just decomposes the graph into different pipeline regions. So if we actually introduce these pipeline breakers here, it means all of a sudden we don't have one pipeline region, but four pipeline regions. And then within each pipeline region, it still behaves the exact same way. We deploy the pipeline regions one after another. You know, if there's just one, it's kind of trivial. If there are multiple ones, they deploy as previous pipeline regions get ready and produce the results. And if there's a failure in one pipeline region, we basically cancel out the entire pipeline region and restart it. So this is actually giving you pretty much the behavior that, you know, systems like batch processing in MapReduce and Spark do. And you can actually do the same thing only by Flink treating the granularity of recovery as a pipelined streaming region. And again, the special case is just, you know, in streaming, you typically have an entire pipelined region where in batch the different forms of materializing streams just decompose into more pipelined regions. This has kind of worked out well for a while. There's, you know, certain implementation issues also, and but this model is conceptually has been around for a while and has actually worked. So the more tricky part is actually if we're looking at the runtime operators, which is also where a lot of the performance difference between batch and stream processing systems is. And let's look at this just from the perspective of a single operation. I think this is one that you can use to illustrate this this example pretty well, which is a streaming join versus a batch join. So how's Flink implementing those two different operations? If you look at a continuous streaming join, the streaming join basically has, you can think of it as two tables. And whenever one event comes from one side, it's inserted into that table and it's joining against the other table. And if an event comes from the other side of the joining streams, it's inserted into that table and joining against the other table. It's like a symmetric streaming join. On the other hand, if you look at how a batch hash join works, what it does is it just first consumes one input completely and ingests it into a table. If that fits in memory, it's fine. If it doesn't fit in memory, it just recursively partitions that table. And then it starts reading from the other side and join against that table, against the in-memory portions immediately, against the partition portions recursively. Concretely, if you would run Flink with this, it would mean that in this case, you're running two RocksDB column families, meaning two log-structured merge trees backing those. Versus you would use one hybrid hash join implementation on that side. Hybrid hash join is, I think, classical join algorithm as used in, you know, Postgres, SQL Server, and so on. This one is really more general. It supports bounded and unbounded streams and can produce incremental results, versus this one, again, works only on bounded data and produces results only at the very end and cannot support checkpoints, but it's an order of magnitude faster. So just saying we're ignoring this and saying, yeah, okay, you know, this is more general, let's just go with stream processing batch processing as a special case and run batch processing on stream processing, I don't think anybody would really do this. It's the same thing as saying, hey, let's run MySQL not on my batch SQL, not on Presto, but on Kafka. So it would work, but it's probably not the best idea. So you really need something that exploits that side in the end. Unless there's some very interesting research breakthrough that comes up with data structures that can solve both things equally well, we kind of need to go and support both. Now, there's a bit of a problem because these two operators also assume fundamentally different threading and data flow models. On Flink's side, this assumes a push-based model, the implementation, which is critical to maintain low latency and support checkpoints. Versus this side here assumes a pull-based model, which can, you know, control. I first want to read this side into the hash table, and then I want to use the other side to probe it. So how does that look in the implementation, right? We have push-based operators in the streaming stack, which just accept data from any input immediately. You can think of them almost like actors, right? The streaming operator is an actor. A message comes, has to treat the message. So if it comes from the left or from the right, and then from the left again, and then from the right, just has to deal with that message, right? And this implementation is good to optimize latency, support checkpoint alignment efficiently, and so on. But it puts the operator under pressure to really accept data at any time, which is just completely incompatible with the idea of how, for example, hybrid hashdown works. So the batch implementation, for example, it has a completely different model, right? It just pulls in streams, and the hashdown would just say, okay, I'm pulling from one side, and when I'm done with that, I'm pulling from the other side. And there's the limitation to be only able to pull from one stream at a time, because this is how, you know, like pulling streams works. It gives you some nice control over the data flow, but it introduces high latency. It's fundamentally incompatible with checkpointing. So one of the big changes that we're doing for the 1.9 version in Apache Flink is actually come up with something that has the working title selectable push-based operators. Not sure if that's the best title. But the idea is really to adopt something that is similar to the non-blocking I.O. model that certain libraries have, right? It's similar to NIO in Java or EPOL in the Linux kernel. So what you do is you subscribe to a set of inputs, and then you receive the pushed events. So in this case, an operator might just say, okay, I'm selecting from the left side, so now I'm getting push notifications from that side, then I can subscribe to the other side. And at some point, I can actually subscribe to both sides and get those messages pushed. Sounds like a subtle change, but it has a pretty big implication on how the whole runtime works. Because it actually gets us to the point that what operators do now is they don't pull data. What they do is they control which data flow paths are active, which ones are open. And then among the active data paths, you have a fully asynchronous event flow model that is completely driven by the network, by the data sources, and, you know, if you have, by timers. Which is exactly what we need for low latency and checkpoint alignment on the streaming side. But by controlling the active channels, we get the control that we need to implement batch algorithms fast. And there's another thing that's maybe a little subtle in here, but that I think is quite interesting. And that is, if you look a little bit into the implementation, if you followed a little bit the developments in Apache Flink over the last years, you'll actually see that we've done a bit of work to introduce something called like a credit model to the network stack, where receivers control the data credit for senders and so on, and can kind of steer and shape the data flow. And it's actually this asynchronous model actually supports to extend this. To affect credit assignment and so on, and to make it even possible to get checkpoints through with this model. So, which is something that was fundamentally not working on the batch side. So, I think this is actually kind of interesting. It sounds like a bit of a detail, but the notion that while the network stack in Flink was always kind of neo-event driven, we've kind of pulled this whole model through the entire data layer now. So I think it's kind of an interesting development. It just means that the entire runtime is just trying to be. An asynchronous event-driven model, but selectively activating and deactivating certain paths along which it wants data to flow. And if you have this notion, you can actually think also ahead. How does that work then for things like side inputs and so on? It's actually quite a powerful mechanism to also implement concepts like that. So that's a pretty big change in the runtime. And so what do we do with all the existing runtime operators? How do we forward change and port them? So what we're trying to do now is on the data stream API, it's a little simpler. The much harder part is actually the table SQL side with a very rich operator set, and also an operator set that's more affected by these changes. If you followed Flink a little bit, you probably have seen that we've gotten a pretty big contribution from some engineering teams in Alibaba, the Blink fork, which was an internal fork that they created of Apache Flink and are now contributing back, which has adopted a very similar mechanism as this. So it's kind of very well possible to do some small interface adjustment and run this on top of a model like this. So in the next release, the Flink stack is going to look a little bit like this. There's the task runtime underneath. We're still supporting two models, pull-based driver model that is running underneath the dataset API, selectable push-based stream operator model that is running underneath stream transformations, which is also what is powering the data stream API. And then the new query processor is running completely on that side, and the old query processor is still running partly on the legacy stack. The long run, I think we're going to deprecate this one over a few releases as soon as we'll see that, you know, like the contributed fork actually can fully subsume this one. This is actually work in progress for the next release, which is a good starting point to talk a little bit about the API. So what does that actually mean about the batch and stream processing APIs in Flink? So first of all, I mentioned it as before. The idea is the dataset API is going to get deprecated because datasets are not a construct that is, you know, a unified construct across batch and streaming. So what we're going to retain is the data stream API with a few extensions and the table table API with SQL, which is also which also has a way of being unified across batch and streaming, and it's still possible to mix and match between those two. So the way why we're trying to do this is because we're also positioning these APIs a bit differently as of recently. So the data stream API is increasingly thought of as an API to build like applications with the requirement to have more physical data types, Java classes, Scala classes, as you need them if you have, you know, specific classes that encapsulate your business logic, and explicit control over state and time. Versus the table API is really more for analytical analytical processing, where you define your programs in a more declarative way. You work on logical schema and get automatic optimization. And without diving into too much detail here, for the table API, you've probably heard this either in Flink or in Beam or some other projects. There's a very interesting way to think of tables as actually a unified construct across batch and streaming, where if you run a batch query on the table, it is the classical thing that you know, if you issue a query against Postgres or Hive or so, you fire up the query, you get one table as a result, batch semantics. You could also think of interpreting a table or reinterpreting a stream as a table, and then you get something like a dynamic table. It's a table that is undergoing constant change as the stream events update the table. And then you can still retain the same interpretation of the SQL query and produce another table, but this table is also inherently updating, right? As the initial table updates, the result table updates. It's something that some databases have introduced under the term of materialized view maintenance, right? For example, you can define in your Oracle data warehouse some table that is a view over other tables, but it's as the original tables get updated, this view also gets updated. And it's not a view in the sense of it's only expanded into a query, but the data is really there. You can access it directly. It's meant to speed up analytical queries. We've kind of adopted this interpretation here. So the result, the changing table that you get, you know, the table that does updates as the original table updates, can again be converted into a stream, of, you know, update commands, or it can actually just be mapped into another system. And then as this table changes, it issues update commands to the target database. And the interesting thing is now, if you actually execute this as a batch query or as a streaming query over time, the resulting output, the result of this changing table, or the result of, you know, if you would reinterpret this stream again as a table, or if you look at this table, it's exactly the same, right? Only that once it's computed in bulk, and in the second version, it's computed as changes. And there's actually an interesting talk just about this idea and all the detailed semantics in the Beam Summit that's following this conference by Fabian and Tyler. It's really just the idea of interpreting SQL across batch and streaming. So if you're interested in this, there are lots of details there. Part of trying to actually make SQL a unified API also means extending it a little bit with constructs that are needed more in this use case or in the other use case. This is just an idea of, you know, how to get the notion of these changing tables a little more explicitly into users' hand, being able to view tables as of a certain point in time and join with tables in a time-aware fashion, that you join with a record that was the latest at that point in time when the other row was created. Sounds a little abstract. check it out inside the Flink documentation, the Flink blog post. It's actually a pretty cool feature. Both, it's very, very helpful for streaming, but I think it's actually an equally nice addition to batch processing. And in the same way, also adding, you know, adding constructs like complex event processing, pattern recognition, and so on to SQL across, like across batch and streaming is something that we felt was needed in order to make this language really in something that, that users can use across both realms. Because I'm actually running short on time, let me quickly dive into the DataStream API. What are we doing there in order to support these changes? We're pretty much trying to expose these concepts that, that I talked about at the beginning here. So while the DataStream API is implicitly supporting bounded and unbounded streams, what the only missing thing is really introducing the concept of a bounded stream explicitly and a non-incremental mode to enable these kind of optimizations, to run different join algorithms in the background and so on, and to let the user not worry about the watermark anymore, which means the system will internally ignore all watermarks that you generate and simply jump from minus infinity to plus infinity at the end of the program, which means you know you don't have to worry about any watermark tuning anymore because, yeah, you're really in a non-incremental mode on a bounded stream. Why would you worry about the watermark? So there's a bit of an open issue what to do with processing time timers, whether you actually just deactivate them or you defer them to be always firing at the end of the processing of a key group. I'll leave this out for now. This is actually, you can probably have a really long discussion about just that point. And the reason why all this, although this sounds really very easy to do, why we actually haven't made this available so far is because if you would actually run this without supporting these batch-style execution optimizations, it would just result in a terrible mess because it would result in running an incremental join but not actually advancing the watermark, so you would never be able to do any garbage collection. You would just let all your state size blow up completely and so on. So this is why, even though that sounds simple, we're still waiting for the runtime changes to go through before we can actually offer this in the API. If we offer this before we make this runtime changes through, it's just, I think it's just the perfect way to shoot yourself in the foot. One last part that is a pretty big discussion of itself that I quickly want to mention here is the whole idea of rethinking how data sources work across batch and streaming. Because if you want to unify the API across batch and streaming, you know, you have to also unify how you get data in across batch and streaming. And this is a bit of ongoing work. I think the design is now at the point where we're pretty much converged with how we want to do it. The current draft is based on using input splits like the batch API did, but producing data through actually non-blocking asynchronous readers, which, you know, again, is the right way to integrate them into this completely asynchronous data flow model that we're using in the runtime. Because most sources actually don't work like this. There's an I/O library on top of that for common source threading models, you know, for like the way, for example, you pull with one thread across multiple partitions in Kafka, or you pull with multiple threads from Kinesis and so on. So basically an I/O library on top of that makes this easier. It's easier for users to handle. And then, you know, the other part is pretty much just solving all the problems that we always had in sources and always wanted to fix. And now finally we had the chance to break and rethink everything and can actually do it. So things like pre-partition, watermarking, event time, alignment, and idleness, and so on. Just, you know, break everything at once. Let me skip over this part and just conclude the talk here, maybe take a question or two. If you're interested in this or any of the, you know, any of the other things that the Flink community is currently working on, there's quite a lot. Please reach out, engage with us. Just, you know, try it out. Whether it works for your use case, give us feedback. Contribute code docs, tutorials. Join a meetup, or just help us make this happen. What I just talked about. Thank you very much.
Okay. Hi. So, if I understand correctly, under the new stream API where you run a batch, you are then capable that the runtime reads all the data in parallel, just like good old MapReduce does. If the original data was a stream and you have operators that maintain state, how do you handle operators that expect ordering in that, in the way the events come in to recover the correct state?
Yeah, that's actually a nice question. So let me actually go back a few slides. Maybe I can draw a parallel here with the way that the stream join worked versus the way this worked, right? So in the same way as something like this is necessary to do an incremental join, if you have to be able to produce incremental aggregates and handle events that come in out of order, then you kind of have to use a data structure like this again. You know, one side only here, not the two sides. The two sides here only needed because it's a join. If you think about not being forced to produce incremental results, and then what you can do is you can just like ingest all the events. You'd partition them anyways by key. You would probably sort them within a partition by key because that's how you group them, and they just do something that I think in MapReduce you always called it a secondary sort or so by event time. Then you just pass over them once within one key group in perfect event time order into the aggregation function. So it actually even minimizes the amount of state you need to keep all around. You always need to keep only transient state for a single key. These are the kind of things that you can swap out behind the scenes. So you could think of, for example, a keyed value set. It's not really backed by RocksDB anymore. It's just a single value within one by key sequence we're currently processing. And you know, as you're processing the events in perfect time order, you're just updating this. You're just keeping the record. And when you're done, you're outputting this, and you're going to the next key again, events in perfect time order. So you can actually, it's much easier to do for a system in the background than in, you know, if they come in any order. Does that make sense somehow? It was a rough explanation, but okay, thanks.